Welcome to Grow and Give, a modern victory garden project from Colorado State University Extension. We're here to help you learn to grow food for yourself, your family, your neighbors, or your community. Want to grow potatoes in your victory garden? Here's an overview on how to have success in growing spuds. Potatoes need rich, well-drained soil, amended with a plant-based finished compost. Avoid fresh manure, as it could have some problems like E. coli or other foodborne problems, and compost that isn't finished yet. In other words, it hasn't stopped decomposing. If you use an unfinished compost, you could be causing some disease problems with your potatoes. So use a finished compost in order to amend the soil where the potatoes will grow. Then wait until the soil temperatures have risen to above 50 degrees. They need to be stable temperature above 50 degrees, so take your temperature of the soil at 8 a.m. in the morning to make sure that overnight temperatures doesn't cool it again. When you're planning for spacing your potatoes in the garden, it depends on which type you're growing. The fingerlings don't need quite as much room because those potatoes don't get too large. So you can put those plants about 12 inches apart. But the larger main crop potatoes or the russets need a little bit more elbow room, so spacing those with 15 inches apart is ideal. The potatoes that you plant are not the ones that you purchase at the grocery store, and we don't recommend you buy your potatoes at the grocers unless they're certified seed potatoes. The regular potatoes that we eat from the grocery store often are treated with an anti-sprouting chemical, and that can really interfere with growing them in the garden. But a bigger concern is it's possible that they might have some kind of a plant disease on them. And while that isn't a problem for you or I to eat, it is a problem if you plant it into your garden. Some of these plant-based diseases can infest the soil and become really problematic to try and get rid of. And so that's not a problem you want at all. Purchase seed potatoes, those that are certified disease-free, at any local garden center, or you could purchase them online. When preparing your seed potatoes, you want the potato part of it to be at least 1.5 to 2 inches in size. It is this spud section that is the food for the emerging plant, and it feeds it as it's nosing its way up through the ground. So don't skimp on spud size. When you get your seed potatoes, most often those that are whole are the right size for planting, but sometimes they come a little larger, and it's okay to cut those seed pieces in half. Just ensure that they're still 1.5 to 2 inches in size, and that they have at least one eye, which will be the plant as it grows above the ground. To cut your seed potato, use a sharp, clean knife and cut those potatoes at least a day in advance of when you're going to put them in the ground. This will let that cut side skin over just a little bit before you plant them. Again, each piece needs to have at least one eye. The eye of the potato is actually going to be the stem of the plant underground and then emerging above ground where it forms leaves and begins to photosynthesize. So treat these eyes gently and don't break them off. They're exactly what you want in order to have your potatoes be a success. When you go to plant your potato, keep in mind that the way a potato grows and sets those tubers, it is all above the seed piece itself, so we won't be finding any potatoes formed underneath the seed piece. So dig a trench in your garden or a hole in the garden and put your seed piece in the bottom. Before you do this, you can mix in a little granular fertilizer. It's nitrogen that the plant needs. Usually our soils here in Colorado have enough phosphorus or potassium, so there's no need to add that. But nitrogen is what this plant needs. You can put in the nitrogen in that soil around the seed piece and then cover it with 4 to 6 inches of soil. Those eyes will sprout and the plant will start to nose up and out of this planting hole. Pay attention to that. When it just starts breaking ground, just starts to emerge, hill that plant up. Hilling up means we're going to take another 4 to 6 inches of soil and pile it right on top of that emerging plant. That way it continues to push up through the soil that we've piled on top of it and finally emerge at the top. We will have put a good 8 to 12 inches of soil on top of that seed piece, which gives plenty of room for that plant to start producing potatoes in between the seed piece and the top of the planting ground. One note of caution, however, gardeners, you don't want to get too greedy and try to keep hilling up and hilling up more than one time. The seed piece has that energy for the plant to grow, but it can become exhausted. So if you hill up once, you'll still have plenty of space. Hilling up 2, 3, 4 times, and you could exhaust the seed piece and you won't get a plant at all. Potatoes are heavy feeders, but timing is everything. Putting in about 40% of the nitrogen that plant is going to need when the seed piece is planted is a good thing to do. And that's usually maybe a tablespoon of blood meal or some other granular type of nitrogen. Then be patient and wait. You need to wait until after the tubers have set on the plant and have started sizing. If you apply nitrogen before this happens, you'll delay tuber set. And that's why a lot of gardeners in Colorado get to the fall and they dig their potatoes up only to find that they're really small and not worth harvesting. Too early an application of nitrogen can interfere with this process, so patience is the key. You need to wait until after the plant has emerged from the ground and after it's been growing long enough to set those tubers in the roots and then size up to at least a nickel size or slightly larger. How can you tell if those tubers have set and have started sizing? You tickle them. This is a technique whereby a gardener will take their fingers and gently push it into the soil and feel around in the roots of this plant to feel for those tubers that have set and started sizing. You have to be pretty gentle doing this. You don't want to break them off of the plant itself because they're going to become the potatoes that we want. If this seems a little nerve-wracking to do, you could always use the calendar method. The calendar method is waiting approximately 6 weeks after the plant emerges from the hill and is actively up and growing. 6 weeks is about enough time for these plants to have set their tubers, and you can reasonably expect that that's a good time to apply the second applications of your nitrogen. That nitrogen is going to be divided into 2 applications, 2 weeks apart. So at 6 weeks of the plant having emerged and is growing, that's when you can go ahead and apply 2 applications of fertilizer. It can be a balanced fertilizer or just the nitrogen, but you want to apply it at 2-week intervals. Is it important to use a granular at this point? No, you can use a liquid fertilizer if you'd like to. Or if you have granular, then you're going to have to side dress, scratching it in and around that planting hill so that it can be wetted in and get down to where the plant needs to take it up in order to help that plant grow. But after these 2 applications of fertilizer, you don't need to apply anymore. That's what that plant needs for the rest of the season. When your plant is up and growing and the soil temperatures have warmed up nicely, mulching that plant in to keep moisture really consistent to it is a good way to ensure that you have healthy, well-formed tubers. Regular irrigation without allowing the plant to get too dry is hugely important. If the plant becomes too dry while the tubers are starting to size up or are in the middle of sizing up, if it gets to be too dry, those tubers can crack or they can become knobby. And this really isn't the quality that we're looking for in our potatoes. So using a mulch like seed-free straw or grass clippings that have been allowed to dry down just a little bit, and those grass clippings did not have any pesticides on them for a previous month. You can use those to mulch in around your potato plant, and that helps keep the moisture nice and consistent to these potato plants. Don't worry if across the season the potato plant flowers and even tries to produce some fruit, but it's in the nightshade family, so don't eat that fruit. You want to avoid that. But don't worry if it flowers and fruits. It's not going to take away from the potato production, and it doesn't mean anything for the overall harvest of the potatoes that you're going to get from it. How can you tell when the potato is ready to harvest? It's going to tell you. Once the vines are about two-thirds of the way died back, that's when you know that plant is going quiet and you're going to be able to harvest your potatoes. Harvesting potatoes is a two-step process. You want to stop the irrigation 2 to 3 weeks prior to harvest. This allows the vines to die back so you can remove them before you start digging around in there. But more importantly, it allows the skin on the potatoes themselves to set and toughen. This means they'll have good storage life. Can you harvest the potatoes earlier than that? Sure you can. It just means that the skin is going to be really tender and easily damaged. We refer to these as new potatoes, and they are really coveted by a lot of cooks. You can, if you're an eager gardener, go ahead and harvest at this point. But if you plan on storing your potatoes for any length of time, you should allow them to sit out there with no irrigation before you dig them up, letting them sit for a couple of weeks. Remove the vines to allow yourself some room when you're going to be digging the potatoes up. And I recommend that you start digging about 12 inches away from the plant. 12 inches away from the plant, if you use a spading fork or perhaps a spade itself, then you can dig gently and lift these potatoes up and out of the ground. If you start in too close to the stem of the plant, there's that heartbreaking moment where you can push that spading fork through the potato that you've really been coveting. And that is just a heartbreaking moment for a gardener that you should try and avoid by starting about 12 inches away from the plant when beginning to dig. Like many plants, potatoes can be short season, mid-season, or long season. The short season plants do extremely well in Colorado because we have a short growing season. And some of those are ones that you might be familiar with. Yukon Golds are really popular, and we can find them in the grocery store, but it is still really fun to grow something that is the gold standard for a dreamy potato. If you want to try to change things up a little bit, Purple Viking with purple skin and white flesh, or Red Norland with red skin and white flesh, are excellent additions. If you're hoping to get a russet potato in a short season, Norcota is the one for you. It's an excellent baker, and it really does produce well for a shorter season. Purple Majesty is different still. It's purple inside and out for those who really want colorful food. In the main crop, Albee's Gold is a nice yellow-fleshed potato, and Sangre, which is a red potato skin with white flesh, is one that we've seen in a lot of grocery stores or perhaps at some restaurants. Colorado Rose, however, is a newer development, and it is an outstanding potato. It's got red skin and creamy flesh, and the eyes are not as deeply set, so it's much, much easier to peel. One of the best russet types for a backyard garden is Kennebec. It's excellent for homemade French fries, homemade potato chips, and it just really does well in a backyard garden. From the United Kingdom is one called Maris Piper. And this is a plant that if you want a whole bunch of potatoes, maybe they're small to medium sized, but they are delicious, then Maris Piper is one for you. This is a plant that just wants to produce its little heart out, and you're going to get a lot of smaller potatoes from it. If you're lucky enough to have a longer season or the ability to shelter these plants while they finish, German Butterball is a taste-off winner across the United States for many years. It can be a little fussy for us to grow here in Colorado. So if you're looking for something that has a little bit more chance of success, Crackled Butterball is a fantastic potato to look for. It's got great flavor, just like the German Butterball does, and it's a little bit easier to grow. A couple other good additions for a longer season plant would be Canela, Nicola, and if you're looking for those russets, the Rio Grande is a good choice as well. Finally, if you're going to store your potatoes, try to have a location that has good relative humidity. Although we can't approach the humidity required for perfect storage at 95 to 98%, we can get reasonably close if you have a root cellar and or some kind of a, perhaps a wine cooler. People convert those. They look like small refrigerators, but you could convert one of those to storing your spuds. In any case, do the best you can in your home. Just try to put them in a cool location. Of course, we keep them out of sunlight. And, use them pretty quickly so they don't shrivel down. You could store them for up to 10 months, but those ones that you've held the longest, then they might get a little shriveled, lose some moisture if they're not stored with humidity. I hope you've enjoyed this little overview. Learn more to grow more by contacting your local CSU Extension office.